92.1 WROI, WROIFM.com. Streaming audio live on RTC Channel 5. And soon we'll have audio and video on RTC Channel 4. That's why Elizabeth is here. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, it is a Monday morning. Time for Doc Talk Radio. Dr. Eric Seward is with us. OBGYN at Woodlawn Hospital. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thanks for joining us again.
And is it going to be dry today? I didn't even hear the forecast.
Relatively, maybe.
Well, that sounds like about
like
every
that?
Day, right? Yeah.
Relatively and maybe. So we'll have to wait and see. But we could use some dry weather.
Yeah. Yes, we could. I think, and we'll get into this, but I was doing a survey of Midwestern cornfields this last week, and there aren't too many of them. a lot of fields are barren.
Especially in the state of Indiana, where we are, I guess, in the Midwest, the last one to get everything in as best we can. So
yeah.
It's been a challenge all spring long, no doubt about it.
Absolutely. I'm going to start this segment out with a shout out to my oldest daughter hit the A standard in the marathon.
Ah, excellent.
A 233 marathon, so she's kind of getting in the money.
Cool.
I don't think our airwaves hit Denver, Colorado, or Boulder.
Maybe, well, they can if you go online.
Well, they can if
That's
you go
right.
online. And I was going to also put a shout-out to Channel 4, so maybe she can go watch the program later.
Sure
but
can.
The 233 is insane. She was... have to go back and look, but I think that's a 5:49 per mile pace.
Excellent.
Which is moving.
Yeah
moving. She has some pretty black and blistery looking toes.
You're recovering nicely, though.
Yeah, but she ran up in Duluth. And I kind of wanted to get into, maybe use that as a little bit of a discussion. Today, I kind of wanted to discuss wellness.
Okay, let's do
sort
that.
Of general wellness, I
right.
think. We doctors, and I think a lot of times patients alike, look at medicine as our job is to find problems and basically keep people alive, keep the heart beating
sure.
and the lungs breathing. But the truth of the matter is that's really probably the minority of what we should be doing. Most of the family practice folks out there could say this. I think when you take a long look at what health is, the least of it is having... you know, a heart that's beating and lungs that are working. The vision that I always have in my mind is the, you know, the 90-year-old guy that you run into out playing golf. I had my 89-year-old tennis player lady who came in and chewed me out about hormone replacement. These two are good examples of, you know, what we really want to accomplish, which is you want to be able to do what you can do all of your life long. And so much of this is out of the doctor's hands and into the hands of the people themselves.
Exactly.
And it's how you live your life. Now, we should be probably arming people with the ability to live a high quality of life. I always think of it as sort of a graph. If you think of a graph and on one side you've got quality of life, and by quality of life, what I mean basically is if you're a quilter or a gardener or a runner, a marathon runner, a golfer, I want to see you able to quilt and golf and get out in the garden and run every day that you're alive. If you
just
can.
As long as you want to.
As long as you want to.
Sure.
As long as you darn well can. And so yeah, we like to have that bottom part of that graph is time. You know, it's years of living. We like to see everybody live to a 90 or 100 or 110. But it's more important that, you know, you're not spending the last 20 years sort of decaying.
Exactly.
And
right.
you want to see those last 20 years to be, you know, as productive as the 20 before
sure.
and the 20 before. So that's sort of the goal. And much of that is something that we as doctors, there's not a pill for that. I can't give you the here's how you play better golf pill. Boy, would I be rich.
I wish you could. Absolutely.
Boy, would I be rich. I'm working on that in my lab right now. I just want you to know.
I hope you get that put together because I buy one immediately.
Yeah. And you'll know the minute I got it right when I actually go out and play a good round of golf. But the truth of the matter is so much of this gets down to how you conduct your own business.
Right.
I always talk when we have people that come in for annual exams, I always have sort of four points. And the first point I've hit on this program before, and it's basically, you know, doing what you need to do from a doctor wellness point of view. So get in, get your screening test, you know, get your PSAs, get your mammograms, get your pap smears, right. get your routine blood work, know your cholesterol. You know, have a relationship with your healthcare provider, whoever that might be. Make sure that you're up to date on things. Once in a while, ask. You know, sometimes even we providers, we're looking through your charts and trying to fill in gaps and connect dots. But you know, it's really I can only help a patient if they come to me. And patients all the time point out, hey, I haven't had this done in a while. Oh, hey, let's do that, okay. Whatever it might be. We've hit some of those key points on this program before. Second thing is sort of what I like to think of as avoiding like obvious known problems. So the don't do drugs, wear your seatbelt, don't drink and drive kind of issues, don't smoke cigarettes, things that we know are health risks. Right. That may be a good topic for another program someday, but really I kind of wanted to focus on the last two, thing number three would be our bodies are machines, you know, and they're meant to be used. And there's up to a certain point, and I don't know what that age is for most people. It's somewhere probably around 30 years old, plus or minus a few. We're made more or less out of Teflon. And I always like to point out that as a 21-year-old, you can abuse yourself pretty darn good. If you wake up tomorrow and you have a come-to-Jesus moment and you get rid of all the bad habits and you start all the good ones, start eating right, start, you know, exercising, get rid of whatever the bad habits might have been, almost anybody can then pick up. And if you come back and measure all health parameters when they're 40 or 50, they're going to be about the same as anybody else. Okay. That adopted that same lifestyle. But there's a point somewhere, 25, 30, 35, where it doesn't work like that. And damage becomes permanent damage. And so part of the key is sort of living our best life and trying to capitalize on the fact that, you know, we do kind of break down in time. This is particularly true when you see people that are in their 60s and 70s. We all know somebody who's 75 who's out jogging, you know, or out right. doing all kinds of. We'll get into this in a minute. I just spent a week riding bikes with some 60 and 70 something year olds who are out there riding bikes and cruising along and having a good old time. There are also some of their counterparts who, if they're not 6 feet under, are sitting around in a nursing home.
Right.
There's just a big divergence of health, and it gets back to this idea of your body is a machine. You got to use it, or it's going to rust and fall apart. The last thing that I would sort of focus on would be diet. And we've talked a bit about diet before. Diet and exercise both are things. I'm a big fan of logging what you do. I think everybody should have a health logbook of some sort. It doesn't have to look exactly like mine.
Okay.
But, you know, get a pad of paper and keep track of what it is that you're doing from a diet point of view, what it is that you're doing from an exercise point of view. If you were to look at my marathon running daughter, she has this very detailed log of not only what she ate and what she did for a workout for running, but also how she felt. You know, when she's feeling worn out or run down, she'll sort of back off on certain things and beef up other things.
Okay.
And the idea is to try to keep yourself kind of functioning at top form. Now, most of us aren't A standard marathon runners. And that's not necessarily the exact, you know, there's not one size fits all or one plan that you put to use for everybody. I just spent the last week on a thing called GOBA, the Great Ohio Bike Adventure. Bicycled all over Ohio, saw the sites of northwestern Ohio, went to Put-in Bay. Never been to Put-in Bay before.
Okay.
I don't know if you've ever been to Put-in Bay.
But I've heard of it. I've not been there.
It's kind of an interesting little island, kind of up in the Port Clinton, Sandusky area, touristy. We rented a golf cart and drove around and went to the beer garden and saw all the touristy sites and had a couple good meals, and that was fun stuff. But the bike part of it, we biked about 50 miles a day for a week. And kind of interesting, there's about 2,000 riders, plus or minus a little, that do this thing. I think in its heyday, it may have had closer to 5,000 riders. Nearly every state has something like this.
Okay.
And I'm focusing on bicycling right now. I'm certainly not trying to get everybody to go out and buy a fancy bicycle and go bicycling, but it's certainly one good example of what I mean by wellness. We had 2,000 people, more or less, riding from city to city. The average age of these things is probably 55.
Wow.
And the above curve is probably the big part of it. You got a few 20-year-olds, and you got a whole bunch of 65-year-olds who are out just cruising along, riding their bikes 50 miles a day, camping in tents at night.
Having a great time.
Yeah. And it really is a lot of fun. And I've done events like this in Wisconsin, probably the biggest ones in Iowa. It's called the RAGBRAI, the Ride Across Iowa. I don't know what the acronym part of that is, but anybody in the bike world knows what RAGBRAI is. And Michigan's got them. Here in Indiana, we have our biggest bicycling event is a thing called the Rain Ride, to ride across Indiana. It's a one-day event from Terre Haute to Richmond. And but there's a big bicycle ride called the Rainstorm that leads up to the Rain Ride, and I did that a few years back. And there are others. The Hilly Hundred's a big one. And things like that, to take it out of the bicycle world, Susan Komen, Breast Cancer Awareness, has a 3-day, 20-mile-a-day walk. A lot of people I know who have been affected by breast cancer or know people who have been affected have been out walking the Susan Komen walk, and every once in a while you'll see people with the Susan Komen shirts on. It's a good idea to challenge yourself, to take that notebook, to pick something to go do, pick something on the calendar. Maybe it's a week-long bike ride. Maybe it's a Susan Komen walk. Maybe it's a half marathon somewhere. Maybe it's a triathlon. We had a nice triathlon here in Rochester a couple weeks ago. And there are about a million ways to challenge yourself. Hike in the Appalachian Trail and pick your thing.
Exactly.
And then it's got to be something you can't just hop off the couch and go do. It's got to be something that you you aim for, you put the work into, and it's a way to get up and motivated, get off the couch, get going. It's less for me about what somebody weighs or how many six-pack abs you have, but more about, how can we live our best lives?
Exactly.
And as a doctor, I think sometimes we lose track of that because what we're looking at are a whole bunch of problems and sort of algorithms for how to get through these problems. And if I was going to stand on a soapbox and preach on the corner, it would probably be, hey, take charge of your own life, get active, get healthy, watch what you eat, learn what works for you. Don't just fall for the latest fad, but log things and tweak things until you've got what works best for you. And then have this relationship with your healthcare provider that, keep in mind that we can be an advocate. We don't necessarily have to just come in when your heart's failing you, but or when you've got a push in my world. but also we can be there to kind of, keep tabs on some of the critical labs, some of the critical vital signs and things that will keep you moving forward.
If you have not had a particularly active, exercise-oriented life and you decide you want that, you probably need to, depending on your age, go into it gradually.
Oh, it's kind of interesting, and this is getting more into the philosophical aspect of exercise, but some of the most longest-lived and happiest societies. I've looked at some of these groups of like people in Japan or people that eat specific diets around the Mediterranean. People that live a long time don't necessarily do extreme exercise a lot. They tend to be people that walk a lot. And so just getting up off the couch, listening to your body and moving. I've been brought dragging and screaming into the 21st century with tech. I've got an app on my Apple Watch and my phone that I
can get a Fitbit.
Yeah, and I can keep Fitbits. You see almost everybody's got something like that on. And you can keep track of your steps. You can challenge friends in a lot of different ways with that. My little watch gives me rings of success. And boy, this last week, they were going crazy. I got to keep that up now.
And then you probably had weeks where they didn't go crazy.
They didn't go so crazy, yeah. Yeah, it's the day-to-day life sometimes gets hard. But I think the key is you got to you got to prioritize that. You got to put these things on the calendar, and then each day you got to get up and do the things that it takes to get there. That would be my best advice to anybody that wants to get started. If they haven't been real active, I would start with walking. I would go look and see what's going on at your local gym, see what classes are available for seniors. There's a lot of Silver Sneaker classes. They're all over the place. It's just a fun little half hour way to kind of get your blood perking and probably go out and socialize a little bit. You go to any mall in America at about 7 in the morning and you're going to find people hoofing it around the outside.
Walkers, sure.
Some of them are people that are cardiac rehabbing, but a lot of them are just, people that want to get their exercise on. There are groups of folks out of just about every gym in America that are going for walks or runs or bike rides. And you can find those groups of people around just within an hour. If you include South Bend, Indianapolis, and Fort Wayne, there's not a weekend where you don't have competing bicycling events, walking, running, triathlons, things like that, every weekend in the summer. And you can't do the triathlon stuff and a fewer bike things, but still a lot of running and walking stuff in the winter, within a short drive of good old Rochester.
Dr. Eric Seward is our guest, OBGYN at Woodlawn Hospital, talking today about wellness and the importance of wellness, the importance that exercise fits into that. This is probably a question which would be a topic for a whole other program, but which is more important, your lifestyle in terms of your wellness or your genetics?
Oh, man, this is a... genetics are sort of, if you could imagine, you're going to make a painting. We tend to think of the skill of the painter and the paints themselves, and those are probably the most important aspect to making a beautiful painting. But you can't forget that there's a canvas. The canvas is your genetics, and we all have certain genetic predispositions. And in our genetic code, there's I think most of us are at some risk for heart disease or diabetes. Some people have risks for cancers. You got what you got, and you've got to work with what you've got. And that doesn't really change the aspect of wellness. It sometimes changes how you do that first aspect, that screening and that relationship with your physician. If you've got high risk issues, particularly at certain points in your life, you need to, and we know this from genetics, then you need to get in and really have that good relationship with your doctor. Okay. Try to preempt things but I think, in all honesty, I've seen a lot of A students in my life, and some of them were just naturally gifted. They could go and sit and listen to a thing once and remember it forever. Others had to work real hard at it. And I don't think in the end you're any smarter or dumber. I think if you have to work real hard at something, right, you probably learn work ethic and you're smart.
Sure.
and you're an A student.
Sure.
And if you're just naturally gifted, God bless you. So with genetics and wellness in general, I think everybody's got the potential to be well. The genetics are something that you just have to, that's your palate, that's just what you got to work with.
You're available if somebody would like to follow up with you.
You know I am.
All right.
I'm heading to the office right from here.
Okay.
I'm in Woodlawn Hospital, second floor, in the Wimpy Clinic, and I've got several, we're kind of a multi-specialty clinic in the sense that we have internal medicine available, we've got family practice, nurse practitioners, pediatrics, and surgeons, and then out in the broader community, we've got orthopedics and family practice in several locations all over. And then some other specialties that kind of come in and visit with us. So, yeah, make your appointments.
Right.
Get in and see me.
Dr. Eric Seward, as always, good information today. Any thoughts about next month?
Oh, gosh, I'm always up for suggestions.
All right.
If anybody comes up with something exciting.
Sure.
I have a long list back in the office, and every once in a while I'll ask people, and every once in a while somebody gives me a fantastic new idea.
Excellent. Dr. Seward, as always, thank you.